The next item on the order of paper is a motion on the protection of Woodburn Forest. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes with concern the application by InfraStrata to drill...
Order, please.
The application by InfraStrata to drill at Woodburn Forest, County Antrim, recognises the concerns of residents in County Antrim over drilling proposals at the forest and calls on the Executive to ensure that such applications are not approved until assurances are secured against any negative potential impacts on water supply, the environment, tourism and local communities.
I call Mr Oliver McMullen to move the motion.
Members, the motion before us today is one that can go a long way in protecting our environment, our water supply, tourism and our communities. It is also a motion that will give the community the right to be consulted at all stages of an application, also the right to express their view to all agencies involved. The granting of a drilling licence without a mandatory environmental impact assessment not only is a major flaw in our planning system, but it also fails to protect the communities and the wider public. Members, let's not fool ourselves. Activities such as gas and oil exploration are not without real and serious environmental risks and problems, such as water and soil pollution. And when you think, I'd ask members to think how close to Woodburn Reservoir this drilling operation is situated, it makes you wonder what people were thinking. In the drilling process, highly toxic chemicals are combined with water to create a mixture that is then pumped into the ground. This mixture then comes back to the surface as a toxic mud, which carries contaminants such as radioactive materials. We have also got air pollution from drilling. This is from gases such as benzene and methane. We will also have oil spills, waste management problems, noise, road damage and landscape impacts. Already we have cut away acres of trees and according to the permitted development schedule, the council must give written consent for this to be done. And I wonder, did this happen? Because we haven't seen anything from the councils at all. Members, given all the risks, it's hard to believe that a drilling licence was granted at all without the need for an environmental impact assessment report. At present, a licence application needs only be accompanied by an environmental awareness statement, which is no more than a brief statement demonstrating the applicant's awareness of environmental issues, regulatory requirements and sensitivities related to drilling, exploration, development and production. In other words, members, nothing even resembling a full independent assessment is required. Basically all it is a nod of the head or a wink of the eye and you're through. Under the EU Directive 2001/42, a strategic environmental assessment is meant to be carried out before petroleum licences are granted. But unfortunately, our licensing policy here does not apply that much needed directive. This assessment, if applicable here, would allow the full examination of effects such as biodiversity, pollution, human health, fauna and flora, soil, water and air, to name but a few. As our planning policy stands at present, the holding of a petroleum licence only has to apply for permitted development rights to carry out exploratory works. A full planning application is only necessary if they are refused permitted development rights, and one of the reasons to be refused if your application needs a full environmental impact assessment. So on this occasion at Woodburn, when InfraStrata submitted their drilling plans in 2013, the opportunity to put this application into full planning process along with a full environmental impact assessment, was missed, was gravely missed. And I wonder how well it was missed. Was it intentional it was missed, or it was just missed? When you look at the DOE's own stipulation for drilling in an area with an ASSI designation, any proposed exploration, the company must consult with the Northern Ireland Environment Agency and all the relevant bodies.
I'm fascinated at the member's litany, and quite correct litany, of concerns that he has about environmental pollution. But, you know, this is the member who is a family member who has been involved with some fuel laundering processes, which are, on the order, record, Mr. Order. Speaker, some can of I, the most polluting activities
call,
in Northern
can
Ireland.
Can I caution the member? The member knows, well knows the rules under which he speaks, and I would advise him to be very careful. Mr. McMullen.
Thank you. The application clearly states the licensee shall not carry out any work within or in close proximity to an ASSI without the prior written consent of the DOE. Now, members, I wonder, did this happen? Because if we really know this area, two of the reservoirs served by Woodburn catchment area are in an ASSI area. So what were these people thinking of, and what was everybody thinking of who was responsible for the paperwork on this programme? Why, you may ask, did the DOE not insist on a full equality impact assessment? Well, basically, it's my belief that, one, the minister then, Minister Durkin, he must have fell asleep at the wheel, because he did write to the Mid and East Antrim Council telling them that they were responsible for removing the PDR. Why did his department not take the lead? And he also failed to respond to the 21-day deadline of being notified of the plans, which meant that the permitted development rights were granted by default. Now, where else would you hear of this? Because when the public, and quite rightly, asked for questions, the council went into the committee, there was nothing coming out. Nobody was telling the public anything at all. And this is something that I was shocked to learn. Detailed of being notified of the plans, which meant that the permanent development rights were granted by default, when the department was asked why this happened, they stated that they, the DOE, had already received sufficient information from the company and the relevant agencies back in December 2013. This I am shocked to learn, that the DOE took the advice from the drilling company and not from their own report. So, as was read in the papers, you have already got one of the heads of planning service was quoted in the papers as asking the drilling company for advice on how to answer some of the questions that was laid down to planning service. We have the DOE taking advice of the drilling company. Did all the rest of the relevant agencies do the same? Is this where we have come to, that on the advice of the person who is applying for the licence, that their word was taken without the relevant agencies doing their own reports? Now, I think there's questions need to be asked on that.
To remind the member to address his remarks through the chair.
Pardon me. Today, members, we have the chance to ensure that this debacle can never happen again. So what can we do? In the wording of today's motion, it states, we call on the executive to ensure that such applications are not approved until assurances are secured against negative potential impacts on our water supply, the environment, tourism and local communities. So how can we do that? Today, I'm calling on our new minister, and I thank him for being here today at the debate. calling on Minister Hazard to repeal the section, to repeal the part of Section 16 of the Permitted Development for Mineral Exploration that deals with oil and gas, and that any future applications by anybody to do an exploratory drill or anything to do with exploration of oil or gas, that this goes through the full planning legislation, has a full environmental impact assessment with it. This is the only way that we can ensure that we have control of our own planning service, that the multinationals do not dictate terms or dictate anything that goes on. We must take control back of our planning service. Members, I hope we get support for this motion here today.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I welcome you to your role and wish you well. I've listened carefully to the member for East Antrim, Mr. McMullen, and also have read with interest the motion that is before the House this evening, and it is a motion that I will not be able to support for reasons that I will outline now. I certainly do understand the concerns of some local residents, the genuinely held concerns that some people have in that area. However, I believe that those fears are unfounded. I hope that during the course of my remarks I'm going to be able to assuage the fears that some people have. However, I'm under no illusion that there are people in regards to this issue that have their mind made up. I understand that, and that no amount of fact or evidence or reason will convince them otherwise, but I hope that I will be able to shed some light on what is taking place. No, because I do have a lot to get through and I only have 5 minutes and other members will have a lot more collectively. I want to raise also the last part of the motion that Mr. McMullen has brought to the House today. And it says that this House is to call on the Executive to ensure that such applications are not approved until assurances are secured against any potential negative impacts on water supply, the environment, tourism and local communities. If those assurances were not already provided, then we would have cause for concern. Then we would have cause for worry, but that has not been the case. And let me address these now. Now, one of the issues that has been raised is in terms of permitted development rights. And some people think that this has given a free run, really. It gives the company, InfraStrata, the power to do whatever they want without any consequences at all. But that's not the case. It's not a free-for-all. Let's go through what has taken place so far. They were required to get the consent to drill by DETI. That's what it's regulated under. And this consent given by DETI says that DETI is satisfied with the technical, environmental and health and safety aspects of the proposed plans. So DETI were pleased, or the former department DETI were pleased. The Northern Ireland Environment Agency, the steps it has taken, it has implemented a water quality monitoring report which includes both surface waters and groundwaters. NIEA also regulates the movement of waste from the site. And in addition, Northern Ireland, or the NIEA, is responsible for ensuring that Northern Ireland's water quality monitoring and risk assessments for drinking water meet the regulatory requirements. So what do we have here when we consider the exploratory conventional drilling that has been taking place at Woodburn? We know that NIEA are content. We know that Northern Ireland Water are content. We know that, no, I've already indicated I'm not going to be giving way. We've heard that DOE are content, DRD are content, and DETI are content as well. So when we look at these in the round, we have a various number of government departments and public bodies who are tasked with ensuring that the environment is protected and that public water is protected. And moving on to the water supply, there have been a number of concerns that have been raised. And I'm sorry that I have to say this again, but it's not fracking. This point has been raised again and again, and I've received correspondence saying what is taking place is fracking and I should be opposed to it. This is conventional exploratory drilling, and we know that no oil will be extracted. Indeed, we know that the chemicals that are used in drilling, and everybody knows that certain chemicals will need to be used, that these chemicals are used in this process all over the world. In fact, they've already been used at Larne Loch. They're used for geothermal energy. They're actually used as well for water extraction. So we have been asked in this motion, I've already indicated I'm not giving away, I'm running out of time. We have already indicated, it's already been indicated, well, sorry, you're right, I got an extra minute. Sorry, go ahead.
The member is so certain that there's no risks, but would you appreciate that sometimes things go wrong? And when things go wrong, there are risks. So the question is, why take on board additional risks in a water catchment area?
I'm glad the member has thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I'm glad the member has raised that issue. That is why the company has said, and why Northern Ireland Water, Derry and others are pleased with what is happening, that there will be multiple layers of steel casing and concrete that will be used to help protect the water supply in that way. And I have a personal interest in this, by the way, as the member does, because we both drink water from that area that come from the rivers that feed into those reservoirs. So what we have, Mr. Deputy Speaker, are a number of public bodies and government agencies, experts in this area, who have informed us that what is happening is in line with policy, is safe and poses no risk to the environment. And what we're actually being asked to do today is to express concern and to ensure that applications such as this are not approved unless certain assurances are provided. And I say again, we'd be right to express concern if those assurances were not there, but that is not where we find ourselves. Mr. Speaker, finally, I just want to say that those who invest in Northern Ireland must be allowed to operate within the framework that has been established already. And I want to see companies come here and be able to operate within the law. That's what has happened in this case. And I have not been convinced of otherwise at this point. And then, for I cannot support the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I too would like to congratulate you on your appointment. I rise to support the motion. I have to say, I learnt of the proposal to drill a borehole at Woodburn inside the water catchment area was quite incredulity. I could not believe that this would be a location that Northern Ireland Water, the company whose job it is to guarantee the water quality for the people of Northern Ireland, would take on board additional risks. Because as I said earlier, when you involve drilling, there are risks. Now, some are using the language, this is a zero-waste site and nothing's ever going to escape. But there are events, dear man, events sometimes can overtake the best of plans. And I would say, why take on board additional risks? Can I highlight, I drive a car. I do have a wood-burning stove, but I have an oil-fired central heater system at home as well. I use oil. So I'm not anti-oil. I'm not coming at this from an anti-oil point of view. We do have to try and conserve our limited energy supplies. But why on earth would you take on board the additional risks by locating such a site within a water catchment area because of those additional risks? I noticed in the Northern Ireland Board meeting of the 24th of July 2013 that the records indicate that the Board was assured that the contamination risks had been dealt with in the preconditions for Northern Ireland Water land being accessed for this project. So you write in the conditions and therefore nothing's ever going to go wrong. What surprised me about that minute is there was no challenge from any of the Northern Ireland Board members to say, what if something goes wrong? And I have to say, I found this almost similar situation when getting involved in discussions with some of the departmental officials, that they just assumed that it's a zero-waste site and they've been assured, and everybody's assured by somebody else. But what if something goes wrong? Why take on board the additional risks? The next thing that highlighted to me is there was concern in the community that this could be fracking here. Now, this was just moving to a different plane. I could not believe that in a water catchment area, if anywhere in Northern Ireland, would be less appropriate for fracking, it would be within a water catchment area. You have pumping chemicals underground, you have the risk of other perhaps heavy metals or other issues coming back to the surface in a water catchment area. This was just ridiculous that could be possible. So I felt that it was important and engaged in 2014 with the department and Northern Water to try and at least seek assurances that there will be no fracking and that they will ensure a highest level of mitigation if they were indeed were going to lease this site out. So that was agreed. I'm glad that the fracking has been written into the lease, so at least the company will not be coming back if they find suitable, actually I hope they won't be, my understanding, if they find suitable fracking below them. It's already built in, they cannot decide, we developed this in good faith and you can't stop us now unless you pay us X amount of money. So I hope we've at least prevented that issue arising. Now, many have referred to the catchment. Now, I've been to this area several times. And met some of the neighbours. Now, the issue that strikes me that people have got mixed up with, it is adjacent to Woodburn North, but it's actually in the catchment area of Woodburn South. So I think there's confusion there. And there is a sluice which can direct to and from. So I understand that mitigation can be built in there, and I suggest that they should build in as whatever mitigation that they should possibly come up with. We've been assured that there's a bund and nothing can escape. What if we get exceptional rainfall and the bund fills up? Northern Ireland has been fortunate to be dry as recent. Yes, I will.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. I have to confess that my own view would be to be very cautious in terms of undertaking a project like this. Having said that, given that the government pays people from Northern Ireland Water, the Northern Ireland Environment Agency, and other statutory organisations like DETI to provide advice to people like himself who are charged to make the decision, why does he think he's better qualified than those who we pay to advise us?
I think sometimes you need a bit of common sense. Why take on board additional risks? Why are you coming here if you can accept what the officials say every time? Sometimes you have to challenge them. Why take on board additional risks? There was a site in the Glenoe area in my constituency. They had an aquifer. A neighbouring well water was diverted. There was lots of mud. At one point, I'm told, the Glen River ran red. Who knows what happens if something similar had happened at Woodburn? So you should not just assume that the officials get it right all the time. Now, the other thing that when I read on about this, and again, I have to say I was just gaining knowledge all along, was the number of chemicals that are involved. And again, this is in a water catchment area. 100 kilograms of biocide. I think that's 24 tons of barium sulfate. 2,500 gallons of Hadel 300 LNS. Both biocide T and Hadel 300 LNS are defined as hazardous biocides under the groundworks. Groundwater Regulations Northern Ireland 2009. Why bring such issues into a water catchment area? Why bring risks upon yourself? So it's because of that I want to avoid risks, and we ought to be very careful in the future, but ever, I'm not doing this ever again. Thank you.
And it's my first opportunity to congratulate you on your role, which we know you'll bring integrity and balance to. The SDLP supports this motion. First and foremost, it's clear that there are very substantial concerns about the proposals for exploratory drilling in Woodburn, and that not enough is known about this kind of drilling and the potential impacts and the effects on local communities, and that we certainly do not have enough information to declare it safe. We had been told that the well site would be fully watertight, a zero discharge zone, and lined with layers of cement and steel to prevent liquids escaping into the surrounding soil and the groundwater. I will.
Is the member aware that already there has been flooding in the entrance lane and that mud was flowing onto the road and ultimately down the stream, which potentially went into the water supply? So they haven't been able to do things properly already.
Well, I thank the member for his intervention, and yes, I have been aware of that, and I believe that InfraStrata themselves have acknowledged some of those breaches, even if others have not accepted that they've had breaches. And I believe this has been compounded by the fact that there haven't been baseline studies and surveys done that will allow us to effectively quantify any environmental damage. And I understand that there are concerns as well that the company doing this exploratory work isn't financially secure and would not necessarily be in a position to fund any clean-up, if such clean-up was possible, in the event of a substantial breach. As a background to how we got to this point, we know that the DOE got an application from InfraStrata InfraStrata in August 2013, detailing their intentions at Woodburn to probe the subsurface geology and identify areas for potential oil and gas deposit. I understand that the officials in the Environment Agency made a determination based on the information available at that time, concluding that the development didn't need an environmental statement and that the information submitted, the proposed borehole was essentially legally permitted development and that planning permission was not required. Post this decision, I understand the further information has emerged about the detail and the potential risks of what was proposed. The work was initially described as minor and non-contentious exploration, which I think we can clearly say that it isn't now, and InfraStrata were latterly granted a licence to re-inject petroleum and other fluids, and I thank the member for outlining what some of those were, into the site, and therefore it no longer could fall into the category of permitted development. After local government reform, the DOE at this point had no jurisdiction over the permitted development notification, which had become at that point a matter for Mid and East Antrim Council. And at that point, in September 2015, the then Environment Minister, Mark H. Durkin, wrote to the Council clarifying this. At that time, he advised that the means of potentially removing the PD rights was for Council to carry out a further EIA screening exercise and consultation based on the new information available. And unfortunately, we think that there was a missed opportunity that didn't take place. If the reforms to planning folks were to do anything, and even though they weren't as comprehensive as we initially designed them to be, they were designed to bring in community consultation and give the people closest to the impact of a decision a say in that decision through their local councillors. A previous speaker, I believe, has continued with the campaign to try and pin the blame on the former DOE minister and department and potentially throw some anti-politics sentiment about why a decision may have been made. And I don't think this is the case. And I think once the details of what was actually being proposed have emerged, there actually have been, I think it's fair to say, a number of missed opportunities to bring the development in. I've outlined the role that MEA could have played on it. DETI, I understand, granted the licence. DRD have influence over Northern Ireland Water, who have a demonstrable interest in protecting our water supply. And indeed, the outgoing Dard Minister has responsibility for the Forestry Service and could have potentially rejected permission to take place yes, certainly.
Would the member agree that this was granted under default because the 21-day term was not taken up and we sat in our hands and let it go through by default and allowing this application to go through?
Well, as I've just outlined, at the time the information available didn't say that it was exploratory, exploring the sub-geometry or whatever it is, and I think after the fact, when the follow-up proposal the follow-up proposal detailed some of the chemicals that were being used, and as I've outlined, a number of departments, including DARD, had the opportunity to pull the development back in. But I think you can take the plank out of your own eye before you start to apportion blame here. Mr. Speaker, the discussion of this matter is frequently raised alongside fracking, and I accept Mr. Lyons's point that it's not the same as fracking, but I think there are some parallels. And on the latter issue, I want to commend Mark H. Durkin for taking appropriate deployment of the precautionary principle during his term and refusing permission for that to take place in Northern Ireland until such time as it has been proven safe, which is certainly not the case at the moment. Although we're far off any confidence that this is safe, we're not blind, we're not absolutist in our position on many things, including this. If we were given evidence that said that this would safe, we would reconsider the position. But I wish that the same efforts and determination and resource that are put into increasingly complicated and contrived extraction methods like this would be put into developing the renewable base here that has so much potential to meet our energy security and to reduce necessarily the greenhouse gas emissions for this place. Onshore wind, for example, is cleaner and safer and less expensive than this sort of tactic, but is being overlooked. Mr. Speaker, we support the motion.
I call Mr. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, Mr. Speaker, to take this opportunity to congratulate you on your appointment as Speaker in the House. Mr. Speaker, I welcome the opportunity to speak on this very important, indeed vital matter for many of my constituents and those that live in a much larger drinking water consumption area served by the Woodburn Dams. Earlier on this evening, I and some party colleagues met with some people from Stop the Drill, particularly residents who live in the most immediate area around the drill site. And they both impressed us and they persuaded us, if we needed any further persuasion, about the folly and the foolishness of this particular enterprise. I equally find it very strange that both Mr McMullen and Mr Kelly are co-signatories to a motion here tonight when they are effectively party of government and they could at the stroke of a pen stop all of this. And it seems rather false that they don't take that course of action. In fact, the motion that's in front of us, which of course I do intend to support,
Stroke of a pen equally applied to the time that there was a previous minister in D.O. Marked out? Because you seem to be attacking Sinn Féin now. Is that true?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The reality is that despite the words which Ms. Hannah used to congratulate our minister on his actions, are indeed that he could have perhaps taken that decision as well. But things are much simpler now because there are just two parties in government and it's very easy. You don't have all the breadth of consultation that you needed to do in the past. The reality, Mr. Speaker, is simply this. Mr. Hazard has the powers to introduce departmental legislation with regards to planning. And that's what this motion calls for. So I look forward to tonight waiting to hear a major announcement from him in respect of planning matters. And furthermore, I'd like to ask the Minister directly through you, Mr. Speaker, will he instruct Northern Ireland Water to release both documents to protesters who believe that there are documents being hidden from them and from the public view and from open and transparent government? And he is a party of open and transparent government, so I'm absolutely sure that he will do his level best to ensure that every document that's been requested is discovered and placed in the public domain. As the motion states, all the environmental factors must be considered before such a serious project is permitted again. Well, why shouldn't they be considered while this particular project is continuing now? Of course we want to protect future drilling opportunities. But, Mr. Speaker, we have a genuine opportunity tonight to stop this quite simply now. I have serious concerns, as others have made, with regards to the way in which the Agriculture Department has an environment portfolio, and indeed the leadership of both of that party is in the hands of the leadership of that department is in the hands of the DUP. Essentially, we have a government lock on this decision that faces this Assembly today, and I would encourage those members that have the power in this chamber to stand up and do what is right and to stop this process now and to stop the potential pollution of water which supplies hundreds of thousands of houses in the Greater Belfast area. This motion should be calling for a strong and independent environmental protection agency rather than the mouse of an organisation that we have at the moment that can't even decide what day of the week it is. I just wonder, will the two parties of government tell us tonight, will they be introducing an independent environmental protection agency into Northern Ireland? Mr. Speaker, I would like to also say that if oil is found, and we need to remember that this is an exploratory drilling process that is going on in Woodburn, and that there is no guarantee that oil will be found, but should it be found, will the Minister give us a commitment tonight that the place where that oil will stay is in the ground? That's where the oil, if it's discovered, should remain. In the 21st century, we do not need 20th century technology. We do not need additional oil in Northern Ireland. We don't need that type of exploration in Northern Ireland. What we need to do is to get smart and to look for the appropriate alternatives that will deliver 21st century energy needs for the whole of Northern Ireland. I have no desire, Mr. Speaker, to see East Antrim turned into the DUP's idea of a Northern Ireland Dallas, no matter how much it would suit the MP for East Antrim.
Thank you.
Before I call the next speaker, Ms. Caoimhe Archibald, this is the first opportunity she has had to speak in the chamber. I therefore would remind the House that it is the convention of the House that there is no interruption during the speech. That is, unless she becomes controversial in her remarks. called Ms. Archibald.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In supporting today's motion, I'd like to touch upon three areas. Firstly, addressing the flaws in the system. Secondly, so-called economic benefits. And finally, some wider environmental considerations. Mr. Speaker, my party colleague has detailed how flaws in the planning and licensing systems have led to the undesirable consequences we now face. It's necessary that we correct these flaws to prevent a repeat situation arising. Therefore, I reiterate the call for a change to planning policy to require mineral exploration, including exploration for hydrocarbons, undergo full planning permission, and it should no longer be granted under permitted development rights. Mr. Speaker, I also call for the following changes to licensing policies. One, the application process for petroleum licences should include the need to carry out mandatory independent environmental assessment. Ideally, this would take the form of a strategic environmental assessment, the like of which is used in Britain for petroleum licensing. This would overcome any gaps allowing exploration to happen in ASSIs or other special areas. And two, the petroleum licensing system in the north places emphasis on maximising the successful and expeditious exploration and exploitation of the north's oil and gas resources. All decisions are made in pursuit of that policy. This must change to become a policy that is more precautionary and recognises the problems of global warming, carbon emissions and fossil fuel depletion, and therefore places primacy on environmental and economic sustainability. Moving on to so-called economic benefits, Mr. Speaker. InfraStrata makes certain claims about the economic benefits of their activities. They said the Loch Nye Basin has reserves that could provide the North energy for 25 years, offsetting the need for international oil or gas imports, that any oil or gas discovered would provide income through tax revenues and royalties, and that there would be potential for job creation and other economic benefits. At best, the claims are vague and non-committal. In general, it is common for oil and gas industry to quote such economic benefits. However, in the case of Woodburn and any other case for that matter, it is unlikely these benefits would be realised. But rather, Mr. Speaker, given the industry is labour-intensive during development phase and capital-intensive during production phase, there is financial pressure to front-load drilling activity, resulting in boom-bust labour economics that none of us want to see. About 98% of potential jobs are associated with well development. They're short-term, low-skilled and predominantly filled by a transient workforce experienced in the industry. Only around 2 to 5% of jobs are associated with production phase and would remain local and predictable. The transient workforce leads to low tax recovery. Also, the destruction and contamination of the natural landscape by heavy industry is irreversible, and any real or perceived environmental degradation will impact on tourism and reduce the demand for agricultural products and agri-food from the island of Ireland. Any tax or revenue generated will go straight to Westminster and not stay in the north. I therefore contend, Mr. Speaker, that we shouldn't be taken in by vague promises of cheaper home-produced fuel and lots of jobs and prosperity. And finally, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to discuss some wider environmental considerations. Oil and gas exploration and extraction are taking us in the wrong strategic direction. Few people now dispute that global warming is a reality and is primarily caused by emission of greenhouse gases, including carbon dioxide. If we continued our current emission levels, the global temperature will increase, with dire consequences, including rising sea levels and more extreme weather. The world community accepts that we must reduce our use of carbon, with the G7 committed to ending the use of fossil fuels and the UN Climate Change Summit announcing the landmark goal, net zero human emissions. The North also recently signed the Under 2 Memorandum of Understanding to limit global warming to an agreed threshold of below 2 degrees Celsius relative to pre-industrial levels. Our strategic planning policy statement states that we must continue to work towards a reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by at least 35% on 1990 levels by 2025. Given all of this, Mr. Speaker, I don't see any other way but to move towards a low-carbon society where we reduce our greenhouse gas emissions and use of fossil fuels. That's the path that both I and Sinn Féin want us to take. That path is not compatible with issuing licences for and encouraging investment in the oil and gas industry. Instead, Mr. Speaker, I argue that we should promote renewable energy technologies and create the legislative and political environment that encourages not only the proliferation of these technologies, but community and public ownership of renewable energy generation.
Call Mr. Mark H. Durkin.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I also rise in support of this motion, and I can't understand why any party or any person would have a problem in ensuring that any application is not approved without assurances being secured against any potential negative impacts on our environment, let alone on human health. Senator?
I thank the member for giving way. I completely agree with what he has said. Of course, we want those assurances. The point that we have made, however, is that those assurances have already been provided to us. You might disagree on the issue of whether or not we should be there, but you cannot deny that assurances have already been provided in those terms.
The member has an extra minute.
I wouldn't deny that assurances have been given. I would maybe question the adequacy of some of the assurances that have been given in the light of recent revelations. This precautionary approach, it is actually essential to ensure confidence in our planning system and indeed confidence in our government here. And I very much welcome the fact that this motion calls on the executive rather than on any one individual minister or department. These projects do tend to be cross-cutting in nature, and indeed the situation at Woodburn pervades on four of the legacy departments, as outlined by my colleague here, Claire Hanna. DETI, naturally enough, have responsibility for licensing. DRD have clear responsibility for water supply and ensuring the safety of it. DARD did have control or responsibility for the forest, and of course DOE. And it's as a former Environment Minister, I will attempt to clarify some of the misinformation that is out there and some of the misinformation that is in here. What we're currently seeing at Woodburn Forest was never subject to a planning application. It is what constitutes permitted development. People are shocked, and rightly so, that something of this scale and something of this nature was not subject to the scrutiny of a full application, and I do have a great deal of sympathy with them. Indeed, before leaving office, I commenced a review of permitted development with a call for evidence in relation to exploratory drilling, with the intention that something like this cannot happen again without the wider consultation and deeper scrutiny of a full application. And I look forward to the new minister concluding this piece of work and working with him on it as well. I've been inundated with angry tweets, emails and correspondence on this issue. I even got a letter from Mark Ruffalo, the Incredible Hulk actor, and believe me, you don't want to make him angry. We all knew he was...
What?
Yes, he really clearly is green, all right. But sadly, most of this has come too late. After responsibility for planning and jurisdiction for this matter had transferred to Mid and East Antrim Council, and I was unable to stop it with the stroke of a pen or a push of a button. Much has been made of the fact that DOE did not complete an EIA on time, and that had this been done, that this situation would and could have been avoided. But while missed deadlines make good headlines, this is not the case. Permitted development rights can be withdrawn at any stage, but as I have outlined again and again, that power and responsibility now lies with Mid and East Antrim Council. Following a meeting with Friends of the Earth and some concerned residents, during which I learned more about this application, I wrote to Council relaying and sharing these concerns.
Moves on from the initial decision to allow or not to object to permitted development rights. Can he explain the comments of his colleague Claire Hanna that somehow the department didn't know that this was going to be an exploratory drill? Under what basis then was it permitted? What did the department know?
I thank the member for his intervention, and I have to say is one of very few members who have had an interest in this issue for some time. At the meeting that I had with Friends of the Earth, with concerned residents, I learned new information about the nature of what was being proposed, the chemicals that may be used to carry out this, or assist in the carrying out of this exploratory drilling, and certainly I became more concerned and followed up with a letter to the Council expressing those concerns. Claire Hannah also outlined, and it was Mr Lyons who, I suppose, tried to establish this, we're not talking about fracking here, but there is always the fear that fracking will follow. And as Claire outlined, as Minister, I did demonstrate a clear and a very strong approach to fracking, and a precautionary approach, actually, to exploration, and one that actually saw legal proceedings taken against me. The SDLP is completely opposed to fracking. We now have enshrined in planning policy a presumption against fracking in the absence of evidence that it's not harmful to the environment.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
And I do recall an allegation from a former DOE minister and Mr Lyons' predecessor in this House that that was a breach of the ministerial code, and there might be further legal action on that as well.
Call Mr Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. We're here because one of the most invasive, destructive and dangerous processes has been allowed to take place without public consultation, without public scrutiny, and importantly, without public consent. There's been a lot of attempts to play the blame game here this evening. I think we have to be honest. Every party that sat in the last executive has to hold its hands up. I'll maybe make an exception to the Alliance Party, and I'll say why in a minute. There was an opportunity to scrutinise this decision. It's been pointed out the failures of DOE. It's been pointed out DARD had responsibility. Pointed out DRD had responsibility. But the whole executive has a responsibility. It's what I was talking about today. Collective responsibility of being in government. In fact, as Alex Atwood is often keen to say, not just being in government, but being in power. Those parties that were in power had the power to act. And indeed, I sought to initiate a petition to have the decision recalled and reviewed by the executive. And that's why I make an exception for the Alliance Party, because they were the only other party that were prepared to sign. I'll give way to Mr. Swan.
Just check the member's memory there about who actually signed. Not Colin.
Sorry, Robin Swan.
Member
did also,
has an extra minute.
Did also sign, but his party collectively did not come on board. And Mr. Beggs. Okay, two Ulster Unionists signed. We did not have the Ulster Unionist Party did not approach me to sign the petition. Ultimately, that's what government's for, to make decisions and to challenge decisions and to review decisions and make sure it acts in the best interest of the people. I think it's clear from Mr. Dirk, and I appreciate he's been honest in the process. DOE was asleep at the wheel when permitted development rights were granted. It shouldn't take FOE, Friends of the Earth, to tell DOE how to do its job or what it has missed, or the minister for that matter. This should have been examined closely at the time. It should have been stopped at that point. But as has been pointed out, there are many opportunities to have stopped this. Somebody who sat on the previous DETI committee, we were told quite openly by the department of its open-door policy to petroleum licensing. The only condition needed to be met by someone seeking a license, and I know Mr. Lyons used DETI scrutiny as an example of how there has been proper scrutiny. The only condition needed to be met was evidence that the applicant could carry out what was required of the licence. DETI holds no regulation beyond that and certainly does not scrutinise the work that passed to the then DOE. Two things need to change. I won't give away the member, didn't give away to myself. Two things need to change here. Permitted development rights has been clear is not appropriate for this type of development. We had to fight to get permitted development rights for solar panels in people's homes. We should not be drilling, particularly in a public forest, particularly in a water catchment area, particularly adjacent to a reservoir. We should not be drilling without full environmental scrutiny and proper independent assurance that it's safe to do so. I've heard a lot of talk about the supposed sort of watertight environment that InfraStrata are operating in. As somebody who was there on Friday and saw the pipe coming out of the site into the forest, presumably for water runoff, it's not exactly watertight, and there were plenty of damp areas outside the site, and everybody knows it's not because of the rain recently. We need to change the open door policy from the Department of Economy. We need to get rid of permitted development rights for minerals exploration, and we need to ensure maximum scrutiny when these types of applications come forward. We heard today about the programme for government, about how this new model of how we're going to do things, and I welcomed elements of it. One of the elements was, we're going to go out to the public, we're going to ask the public. Well, I have here a petition signed by close to 65,000 people objecting to this. If we're to see from this new executive a new model, paradigm shift as it was described earlier, then we need to see listening from our executive. We need to hear that the people do not want this. We need to stop the drill.
Call Mr. Jerry Carroll.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I think it's very important that the Assembly debates this, particularly given the massive environmental hazard that faces Woodburn Reservoir at the moment. And it's nothing short of a disgrace that this drill has been given the go-ahead just 300 metres from Woodburn Reservoir. And the potential risks to the water are obvious. Dangerous chemicals are used in the drilling, and the oil well itself sits in a reservoir catchment area. And the reservoir supplies water to thousands of homes across Belfast, including in my own constituency in West Belfast. And it is absolute madness, Mr. Speaker, that this drill has been given the go-ahead by politicians. Not only have we allowed InfraStrata to drill on protected land, drilling for fossil fuels which are ruining our environment, but we are allowing them to run the risk of contaminating our water supply as well. It is simply unheard of for an oil well to be situated in the catchment area of a reservoir, and the fact that some politicians have allowed this to go ahead just shows how out of touch some of them really are. We should be exploring ways to increase our renewable energy and setting an example to the rest of the world, not digging for oil beside a major reservoir and potentially contaminating our water supply. And indeed, the draft programme for government that we had a discussion about earlier today talks about reducing a commitment to reducing greenhouse emissions. So I want to ask tonight, will the executive intervene to halt the drilling at Woodburn? And I have to say that it's a shame on politicians who let this drill go ahead. It's a shame on NI Water for putting the interest of corporate profits ahead of safety and hygiene for our drinking water. And I want to offer my support to the campaigners who have worked tirelessly over the last few weeks and months to highlight this issue. This drill must be stopped. We can't risk our water, and we need to put the environment before the interest of big companies. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Before I call Mr. Eamon McCann, this is Mr. Eamon McCann's first opportunity to speak as a private member. I would remind the House that it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. That, of course, is predicated on whether or not there is sufficient controversy within the speech to provoke an intervention. Mr. McCann.
Thanks very much. There'll be nothing controversial in anything I say, as always. I was struck listening to some of the bells kept ringing in my head, Mr. Speaker, if you know what I mean. Because when you talk about Woodburn and what's happening there, the phrases being used and the problems being described, I thought Mowbray Road, I thought Dalradia, I thought Prehen Wood. If you want to know what all those are, they're all examples of exactly the same thing as has taken place at Woodburn. Ideologically, economically, in terms of politics, what we are witnessing, Jerry Carroll was right and Steve Agnew was right, what we are witnessing is a clash between the interests of business, the interests of profit on the one hand, and the interests of the people on the other. This is about rapacious capitalism despoiling our country and our countryside. That's what's happening here. I mentioned Mowbray Road. Most of you probably haven't heard of Mowbray Road. Well, you will. You will. Before the year is out, you'll know all about it. At Mowbray Road, just outside Derry, in the townland of Campsie, there is an illegal dump which, at a conservative estimate, and the previous minister, Mark Yates here, I think will confirm what I'm saying, at a conservative estimate, holds 1.2 million metric tonnes of waste illegally dumped. Members of the Assembly, you don't dump 1.2 million tonnes of waste all announced, as we say around Derry, out of sight of people. Loads of people knew that that was going on. It's a wide area. The former Minister Mark Gates Durkin was good enough to accompany myself and members of Friends of the Earth at the Fochan River Anglers, the Enochuk Forum, and many other people from around that area on a tour of what's there. I tell you, you should go and see it. You should go and see that dump. See the lagoons, as they are called, where water is gathered. See the bubbles coming up from down below. Not little bubbles like in fizz, like huge bubbles. Bloop, bloop. Sorry?
I ask the member to return to the debate.
Yes, indeed.
Woodburn Forest.
Yes, indeed. What I'm saying, Mr. Speaker, and I think it's necessary to say this because I don't think we're dealing with the issue which arises if we concentrate on Woodburn only. What I'm saying is precisely that this is not a one-off, that this is part of a pattern, and I'm attempting to illustrate the pattern of which the problem immediately before us today is part. Did I mention Mowbray? But also, if you, the Prehan Wood, exactly the same thing happening. Prehan Wood is a little clump, that's all that's left of it. It's a clump of pristine greenery along the banks of the Foyle, just outside Derry. It has been treated in exactly the same way as the area of Woodburn Forest, another little forest. It's the last pristine piece of forest in what once was a forest running all the way from Derry to Strabane, all cut down and destroyed. We've got this little place. It's got red squirrels, it's got buzzards, it's got badgers. It's got, when I was a kid, it was known as the bluebell wood because you would actually collect an armful of bluebells. Well, all the kids did that. Take them over Craigavon Bridge home. The magical thing was, Mr. Speaker, that when you came back next week, they had returned. It was still carpeted with bluebells. That is under threat. That is something precious. You can't put a price on that, and on that experience. People are entitled to beauty as well as bread and the means of somewhere to a house to live in and all the rest of it. We're destroying the beauty which has been bequeathed to us by nature. There's a housing development beginning at the edge of Prehan Wood. The developers have the nerve to advertise it as Prehan Wood development. It literally abuts the forest, and it has been given a planning permission. And that's what I mentioned. Here I come to the real connection between these things is this, that I could mention Dalrady and the gold mining, but I don't have time. The planning service, I could bring you the correspondence between the planning service and the Prehan Historical and Environmental Society, in which they were treated like dirt, in which it was quite clear that the planning service was laughing at them. And indeed, when the Information Commissioner twice intervened and told the Planning Service, give these people the information they're asking for, they're entitled to it, there was no result. That's sort of just this mulish reluctance even to comply with their own regulations and with the law, leaving people exactly the same as happened in Woburn.
I ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Exactly the same as being. What I'm saying is this, that in each of these instances, what has happened is the commercial interests have trumped the interests of the environment. That's the real context in which we've got to understand these things. And whatever we do, super councils and the rest of it, unless
the member's time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
I call the Minister, Mr. Chris Hazard, to respond to the debate. The member has up to 15 minutes.
Good, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the members who have tabled this motion here today, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on what is an important issue that has attracted significant concern and public interest. Indeed, I have been very conscious of the concerns of residents in Antrim and further afield about the exploratory drilling at Woodburn Forest. Las Concolla, the ongoing development at Woodburn involves InfraStrata carrying out an exploratory borehole at Woodburn Forest in order to understand the subsurface geology and identify areas where there may be the potential for oil and gas deposits. These drilling operations are not for the unconventional extraction of hydrocarbons. At the outset, I would like to assure members that the work is restricted to exploration only and for a limited period of time. If commercial extraction was to take place in the future, it would be subject to the full planning application process, environmental assessments and assessment of all the potential impacts, including the impacts on water supply, the environment, tourism and local communities. Given the nature of this development and the issues raised, responsibility cuts across a number of departments, including the Department for the Economy, Department for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs, and indeed my own Department for Infrastructure. As the Minister with responsibility for planning, I aim to continue to improve our planning system and to make sure that it is effective and efficient and that it operates in the wider public interest. I am committed to ensuring that it delivers for local communities and the region as a whole, and that the planning system addresses the present as well as the long-term future needs of our society. The planning system should, where possible, facilitate development, but it must not compromise on environmental standards. Sustainable development is at the heart of our planning system, and it is clear that there will be many instances where it is necessary to balance competing social, economic and environmental interests. Whilst the planning process may not always be able to reconcile competing interests, transparency, fairness and accountable decision making are fundamental to ensuring all interests are taken into account. Minerals are an important natural resource, and their exploitation makes an essential contribution to the North's prosperity and well-being. The minerals extraction industry provides employment, often in rural areas, and produces a wide range of products for a variety of purposes in construction, agriculture and industry. I want to facilitate a sustainable mineral development and balance that with the need to protect the environment and ensure compliance with all environmental regulations. As a result, I have decided to propose a change to the current legislation, policy and procedures in relation to mineral exploration. I propose to remove permitted development rights for oil and gas exploration. In the future, under my proposals, exploration for oil and gas will require the submission of a planning application and be subject to the full rigours of the planning process, including environmental impact assessments and public consultation. I intend to consult on the legislative change shortly. As I have indicated, given the nature of the Woodburn development, responsibility cuts across a number of departments. The work is being carried out under a licence awarded by the former Department of Enterprise, Trade and Investment, now the Department for the Economy. The initial licence was granted for 5 years in March 2011, and a further 5 years was approved earlier this year. The Department for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs also has a range of responsibilities, mainly through the Northern Ireland Environment Agency, which is responsible for water quality and environmental protection. Their water management unit granted consent under the Water Order to regulate any potential impacts upon surface water and groundwater, and as a result have implemented a surface water and groundwater monitoring plan. NIEA is also responsible through the Drinking Water Inspectorate for ensuring that NI Water's drinking water supply meet regulatory requirements. My department's primary role is in relation to the associated planning and water responsibilities. Sorry, I just want to go through this. Firstly, in relation to planning, the work at Woodburn is currently being carried out within the existing legislative framework for assessing proposals for mineral exploration referred to as permitted development. Existing permitted development rights are provided for mineral explorations by Class A of Part 16 to the schedule to the planning order in 2015. This permits development on any land for a period not exceeding 4 months of the drilling of boreholes, the carrying out of seismic surveys or the making of other excavations for the purpose of mineral exploration. There are a number of other conditions which apply, including the storage of topsoil and restoration of the site. Under Article 7 of the Planning Order 2015, there is a requirement to notify the relevant District Council of their proposed exploration, and the Council may, within 21 days, issue a direction, if considered appropriate, that permitted development rights under Article 3 shall not apply to development, therefore requiring the submission of an application for planning permission. This still remains an important safeguard. In addition, where an environment impact assessment is applicable based on the details of the proposed development, PD rights cannot apply. It is important to emphasise that the temporary permitted development rights for minerals exploration do not allow the commercial extraction of minerals, including oil and gas. Such activity will be subject to the full planning application process, as well as the relevant EIA, licensing and environmental permitting arrangements. In April 2015, the vast majority of planning powers transferred to local government, and therefore over a year the planning responsibilities at Woodburn have been a matter for Mid and East Antrim Council. Up until that point, the former DOE had responsibility to consider permitted development notifications. In August 2013, InfraStrata submitted a permitted development notification to DOE detailing their intention to carry out an exploratory borehole in Woodburn Forest. In addition to the provisions of the permitted development legislation, environmental impact assessment regulations also require consideration. In the case of the InfraStrata proposals, an EIA determination was carried out which concluded that the proposed development did not need to be accompanied by an environmental statement and therefore planning permission would not be required. InfraStrata were advised of this in December 2013. Following the transfer of planning powers in April 2015, the jurisdiction for the proposal moved to Mid and East Antrim Council, and it is understood that the Council sought legal opinion on the project and were similarly of the opinion that the operations were indeed permitted development. Members should note that the Council's procedure in respect of Woodburn are currently the subject of a legal challenge. In this regard, it is not appropriate for me to comment further on these matters. If the company does find oil and gas deposits from its current exploratory work and wishes to extract them, then it will need to apply for full planning permission to Mid and East Antrim Council, or my department if the amount extracted exceeds 500 tonnes per day in the case of petroleum, or 500,000 cubic metres per day in the case of gas. If the proposal involves the extraction of unconventional hydrocarbons, then the application would be reasonably significant development and would be considered by my department. A number of issues have also been raised in relation to the impact of the exploratory borehole on water supply. NI Water owns the land at Woodburn Forest and has entered into an exploration agreement with InfraStrata. This agreement allows for the construction of an access road and the drilling of an exploration well. If InfraStrata wishes to move ahead with the oil production, the agreement allows for InfraStrata to exercise an option for a long-term lease. However, this option is only exercisable if InfraStrata receives full planning permission for their production well and any associated infrastructure. As previously referred to, there are other regulatory safeguards currently in place relating to pollution control, groundwater regulation and water abstraction practices. NI Water has in place drinking water safety plans for all of its water treatment works and supply areas. These plans identify the potential risks within the catchment and, where needed, put in place any appropriate mitigation measures and controls to protect drinking water quality. NI Water also works closely with NIEA to minimise any potential impacts on drinking water quality and monitors risks as part of the drinking water safety plan process. Before entering into the agreement with InfraStrata, NI Water gave careful consideration to the protection of the water supply in the catchment area of the site. The exploration project at Woodburn has been designed as a zero discharge site. This was achieved through the development of a fully bonded site lined with a specialised geosynthetic clay liner which prevents liquids on site from soaking into the ground below. In addition, NI Water has taken further precautions in order to allay concerns that the public may have and has put in place increased monitoring of raw water at all reservoirs within the catchment area and at the associated water treatment works. NI Water has also ensured that the portion of the Woodburn North River, which is within the catchment area of the drill site, is not currently flowing into any of its reservoirs. While NI Water is of the opinion that the project is well designed and well managed, this is a belt and braces approach to provide further reassurance to the public. NI Water is satisfied that the proposed work will have no detrimental impact upon the impounding reservoirs or their public water supply. Clearly, the ongoing work at Woodburn has generated significant public concern. However, one of the key restrictions to the permitted development for mineral exploration requires that development does not exceed a period of 4 months. I am advised that this time restriction will expire in a few weeks in early July. Permitted development legislation also includes a number of conditions regarding reinstatement of the land, including that within 28 days of cessation of operations, the borehole shall be adequately sealed, any structures and waste material removed, and the land restored. Given the short remaining timeframe for the Woodburn development to operate within the permitted development framework, and the fact that the jurisdiction for this matter is a responsibility for Mid and East Antrim Council, there are very limited opportunities for myself to act in this case. However, this case has highlighted to me the need for change. I am very conscious of the need to ensure that permitted development rights are fit for today's purpose. And that is why today I have proposed changes to permitted development rights, and I look forward to working with the Assembly and the industry taking these proposals forward. Last Concolia, I have asked my officials to take note of the Hansard report for this debate, and if I have not addressed any points that have been raised by members during the debate that fall within my remit, I will write to them in response. Gormilgut.
I call Mr Gerry Kelly to wind up the debate on the motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
I'd like to congratulate you on becoming the Speaker. Oliver McMullen opened the debate and really summed up the difficulties right from the start. He asked the question, why did the previous minister, the DOE minister, not insist on a full environmental impact assessment? And why was there a failure to respond within the 21-day deadline? So he gave what I think most people agree to him, what the Minister dealt with in the end, the repeal of Section 16 of the Permitted Planning for Mineral Exploration and all future applications to be put through full planning applications. Gordon Lyons got up and said that he was happy with the assurances provided because he came from Data and a number of other agencies which he mentioned. I suppose the question I would put back to the member is, well, if there is any difficulty with that, if you think that there are no risks, then what is the problem with full planning permission then being used in these terms, especially when you think about it, if you're building an extension onto your house as a single parent, as a single person, beg your pardon, if you are a single parent, as a single person, you will have to ask for full planning permission. So a single person has to do this. And yet not having to do that for a number of the number of people who are affected, many of them personally above us here, is something like 1,800 streets, which includes over 500 in Belfast. Roy Beggs, I think, took up the challenge from Gordon Lyons and said that there are risks, and he went through a long litany of those risks, which he'll be glad to hear I'm not going to repeat. But he did articulate the risks that I think most people, most MLAs agree with. Claire Hanna said that the original decision did not have all the facts and that neither was further information. She defended her colleague valiantly, Mark H. Durgan. I'm not too sure if she did it well by blaming everyone else, but she did support and is supporting the motion. Stuart Dixon said this was a very vital matter, but then tried to launch a very vicious attack on the proposer of the motion, which I think was quite despicable. He says it was a simple matter of to a stroke of the pen. I think when we get on to the minister, we will find out that it's not simply a stroke of the pen, but it can be done, and the minister has outlined how it can be done. Keith Archibald said that the law should be corrected because it's flawed, that the licensing should be by a mandatory and, I think, very importantly, independent environmental impact assessment, so that there can be no question of those of an impact assessment. She also said that we were going in the wrong strategic direction, which I agree with her in terms of what we should be doing is reducing our dependency and indeed our use on fossil fuels. So it's not just, I think, as Eamon McCann later mentioned, to do with Woodburn Forest, it's to do with the whole of the North, and indeed, if you think about it wide enough, the whole of humanity. Mark H. Durgan, who also supports the motion, it's important to say, explained that it was not a stroke of pen in his case or anybody else's, and that there were other ministers involved and indeed councils, some of which, of course, was disputed by Stephen Agnew, who got up after you. He said it was a huge decision and it was without public consultation or public agreement, and I think it's very important to try and rectify that. He also said not to play politics with it, but then blamed all the other parties, but all's fair in debate. But he is also supporting the motion. He argued to change, as others have, to change permitted development rights and that there must be full planning permission and maximum scrutiny. Jerry Carroll got up and spoke very briefly. He mentioned the fact that the thousands of homes, including West Belfast, are affected and others, and it is over 1,800 streets, as I remember. It was unheard of to have a drill so close to any reservoir as we have in the circumstances we're talking about here, and he supports the motion. I notice he mentioned a number of times about politicians. I think I should remind him that he has now entered that field himself, so he shouldn't be getting referred to as a politician also. He also said that put the environment, as Ian McCann did indeed, put the environment before a big business, and in this I absolutely agree with him. Eamon McCann, with his usual passion, said that this is not new. He named a number of other examples, only a small number of them, of which clearly there are many, and said that this was capitalism versus the ordinary people and capitalism versus the environment. He also said that this was much more widespread, and we will see that as we go on. He very eloquently said, I think, you can't put a price on nature or natural beauty and his demand for change. In terms of the Minister, Minister Hazard, which he doesn't mind me saying is either a very appropriate or inappropriate name for the debate we're involved in, went through a whole litany. He went through the history of this. He went through what the difficulties are. He agreed with many of the speakers in terms of that. But let me get back to this stroke of a pen comment which was made earlier. While it cannot be done by a stroke of a pen, it can be done. And the Minister has pointed out that he intends to do that. I'm not even going to try and go through all the issues that he raised, but he put a plan forward. It is in the Hansard. People can read it. The demonstrators can read it and all of that. I am very confident that we will end up dealing with this matter under this minister, even though, as he pointed out, there are all other ministries and agencies involved in what is necessary to deal with. So I commend the motion to the House.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Item 6 on the order paper is the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned.